Extraordinary People. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living.
My guests have changed the way many of us look at everyday objects, and by doing so, have created one of the most internationally recognized and popular theatrical experiences. It is thanks to them that the modest matchbox, broomstick, dustbin lid, and even the simple lighter have acquired the status of artistic objects full of bursting energy. They have not just developed an exciting and fresh mode of entertainment, but also a medium which transcends language and which has enthused hundreds of thousands of people from different cultures around the world. They are the co-creators of Stomp, Steve McNicholas and Luke Cresswell. Hello, you two.
Hello.
And welcome.
Hello.
I probably should have said Dr. Stephen.
Yeah, I concur.
Because you did receive an honorary doctorate from the University of Sussex.
We did. We had to put funny gowns on and stand there, and it was a very strange experience. But we were very honoured.
Yeah. Because we're both total failures in the education system. So.
Right. So that was the... Well, it doesn't get much more honourable than that. And you have had so many awards over the years. But I think I want to go back to the kind of fairly modest beginning of how it all started with Stomp. And I wish you were going to say to me, you know, we were sitting in a pub one day and Luke was going, or something, I don't know, and Steve would say, I've got an idea. But it wasn't quite like this, right? You came from two different groups of...
I think it came from being street performers, and we were in a street performance band at the time, and Steve was a musician in the band and I was a drummer in the band, and I think it was two things. First thing was learning how music can be used as a language, really, how you can, because especially if you're playing in different countries as street performers and bringing audiences in and working with audiences, and as a drummer realizing that that's a very powerful way to work with people. So I think a lot of the origins of Stomp come from that.
Yeah, I think we learned all the tricks of our trade on the street. And
doing it yourselves.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, we used to play here in Brighton, Gardiner Street.
Yeah, there's no harder audience than stopping an audience who could be anybody and trying to engage them and trying to perform to them. Yeah. I think it's much easier if people buy a ticket and they want to enjoy it. Right. It's much harder when they're going shopping and you're stopping them, or they're running
Absolutely.
For a bus.
You were with Cliffhanger.
Yes.
And you were with Pookie Snackenberger. And you kind of joined forces at some stage.
Superpowers of the street came together.
You know. Yeah, what we did was with Cliffhanger, I've been to Edinburgh Fringe a couple of times, and it was Pete McCarthy who was in Cliffhanger. He said he'd seen this band down the seafront, Pookie Snackenberger, and he wanted to have a street musical with where Cliffhanger and Pookie Snackenberger came together, and so that's what we did. And it was called, the musical was called Rockabilly Voodoo. And was that 1981? Was it?
I have no idea.
I think it was 81. And we took that to Edinburgh, and we just did it in the street, in an old courtyard in Edinburgh.
Right.
And it was huge success.
Right, and kind of never looked back?
No, well, after that, I started performing with the Pookies as well, because I'd written a lot of songs for this musical, and those songs started to become part of the Pookie repertoire, so I became a Pookie as well.
And you did the advert for Heineken, didn't you? Which is a sort of was a pre-Stomp.
That was a priest. Yeah, that was a sort of towards the end of Pooks, I think. And I was doing individual sort of drumming. I was just getting more and more into performance because that was how that sort of led me. So I was doing lots of individual drumming things, and we did the big bin routine, which was inspired by seeing the Burundi drummers in Covent Garden when we were busking. And then those ideas sort of hang around for a few years, and then we worked together doing more serious music, and signed to London Records and more pop stuff. And I was playing with lots of other bands and musicians like Norman Cook and all that sort of stuff. And then Stomp, you sort of look back on that time and you suddenly go, but hang on a minute, you know, there's something unfinished business with all of this and these ideas are great. And then we put Stomp together for Edinburgh in 91.
Yeah. Right. So it's because all these, you know, we were playing with dustbins and you know, brooms for a charity event at the the Theatre Royal, wasn't it? Brooms. Toyed around with all these things, and I think it was only over a course of a few years we started to realise that there was something in the way these things work with the audience.
I think the ideas worked as individual things. So we were coming up with an idea like to hang off the pier and drum it, or to do a broom thing somewhere here, or I couldn't see that as more than a 10-minute thing or a 20-minute thing.
Right.
And then it was me and Steve sit together and go, well, actually, it could be a whole thing? And if it was, would that be really boring? Or how could you do that with no words, no melody?
Right,
no,
right.
So that was what I think took time to look back and
I think
together.
We first had that discussion. It might have been the night
I was tapping my thing and you said there's a show.
I think you'd done brooms and then you did like a little solo thing with just a dustbin in it. And it was after that we sat down and said, do you know what?
We put it all together. I saw Stomp in the early 90s and I have to say I was so excited by it. I went home, and I'm sure like a lot of other people who would, I kind of started tapping and drumming on everything, and it was like nothing, or there was nothing else, you know, before Stomp. You know, there was nothing like it. Then, of course, came the stage when I wanted to tell people about it. And then you say, you got to see these guys, they drum on things. They, you know, you don't quite know how to describe it, because... Well, no description would quite convey the...
I think there's an inner drummer in everybody. I think, you know, you see people drumming on steering wheels or tapping and doing... I mean, I think everybody has that. I think there was always a time that, you know, you could only be a... You know, as a person, as a drummer growing up, you know, you had to try and be a very good drummer, you know, or you drummed in something which was like either some sort of religious thing or a marching thing or something, community-based thing. You couldn't, you know, so to try and put something together that... You don't have to be the best drummers in the world to do something really rhythmic and interesting. You just have to have the right ideas to work with those people. And I think that's why it's worked so well.
And even if you're not a drummer...
Absolutely.
Or even if you're not, you don't have, you know, a fantastic sense of rhythm, it is a very basic thing, isn't it?
Everybody has a sense of rhythm. It's just some people have a very unique sense of rhythm that no one else can understand.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, but everyone has a sense of rhythm.
But we weren't aware of this when we put it together.
Right. It was a process in which you discovered...
We weren't aware of how it would affect people. We were really inspired by seeing that friends of ours had a group called Moving Picture Mime, and we loved their shows. To watch an hour or so of them telling stories and being hilarious without ever saying a word. We found that really inspiring.
Right.
And we thought, well, with these rhythmic ideas, there's a way for us to create a show in a similar vein. But we didn't have any clue as to how much it would tap into the audience.
It was, well, that must have been a fantastic kind of revelation.
Well, it was a slow revelation.
It was a slow revelation.
I mean, people always think there's that magic moment where you suddenly have an idea and it just explodes. But I think most good ideas are several ideas that come together over time. And it was the first time you really got that feeling was when we were performing in Adelaide Festival in Australia. And we had the midnight slot, and it was baking hot, with the last show on, you know, it's the death hour slot, and we suddenly just sold out for the whole... It was like everyone was clamouring for tickets, and all of a sudden it was like, oh, it's... And then and that was a good 2 years, well, a good year after we'd first done it at Edinburgh. So then we realised that it was something that this sort of very small project had suddenly gone sort of mainstream without us having to change it. And that was an interesting time.
And yet you've managed to maintain... You know, it became a huge thing, obviously, but you managed to maintain that kind of street performing element and the nearly intimate relationship, I think, with the people who watch it, don't you think? Or do you miss somehow your own experience with
I think it's very important that the show connects with people. It's all about, it's about, you know, engaging people in the audience and using that energy and taking the show through. If it doesn't do that, then it's very difficult. But all drumming does that. You can't go to Brazil and watch Carnival without getting involved in the rhythm. If you don't get involved in the rhythm, there's something wrong. And, you know, and the same with any sort of music. You don't go to a rave gig and not jig up and down to the music unless it's crap. Yeah. So you know, I think theatre sometimes is a problem as they put the fourth wall up. And I can't stand watching theatre when they have sort of music going on and the actors are dancing and we're just sitting there really still. And it's like, you know, I didn't want to do that.
Yeah. So you knew you didn't want to do that.
Well, I couldn't do that. No. It's not our background.
Yeah. I think when people come into the show now, new performers come into the show, I think really what we're essentially doing is teaching them to become street performers. That's what they have to be.
Right. Yeah. We're going to take a little break now, but we'll continue after the break.
Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Extraordinary people. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living.
Welcome back. With me are the Stomp founders. And just before the break, we talked about how exciting the whole thing was and how you managed to kind of maintain it as a fresh and exciting thing. But it's nearly 30 years now, isn't it, since you started it?
Creaking,
but not
we're creaking.
Stomp. You're creaking, but not Stomp. What's the secret? What's the secret of the show to start with? And how do you manage to keep it so fresh?
I think it's casting. One of the earliest things that happened with the show is that we realised that the concept of the show was bigger than the performers. So the ideas and the choreography and the shape of the show was a bigger thing than me as an individual performer or any of the individual performers. And once we started to change people in New York, they brought their energy into the show. So the New York show became very much like most people think it's from Brooklyn. And it feels very... Right. And so when you had a London show, it would feel like a London show. The New York show would feel like a New York show.
Right.
And I think that's... And now that's continued to happen. So the show that's in New York now or is on tour in America is obviously the fifth generations of Stomp. And they bring their new... They bring their energy to the show. Right. And they bring their youth to the show. And they keep the show, therefore, feeling contemporary. So it's... Otherwise, it would be like, you know, be like rhythmic versions of the Rolling Stones, and it would be dreadful.
It's the thing is when we cast someone in the show, we cast them because we think they're going to bring some.
Right. New so it's element. Not enough to be a good drama or a good mover.
No,
you want that extra.
No, you want that. You know, you're looking for a certain amount of charisma. You're looking for a slightly different approach, so that the people who they may play the same roles and essentially the same music, but that. But we really cast people who've got a real sense of individuality about
right.
them.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, anyone who's got a sense of rhythm can be taught drumming.
Right.
But you can't teach, you know, charisma or necessarily or energy or enthusiasm or.
And there's a lot of humour in the show as
and
well.
A lot of humor, and backgrounds and culture and being diverse. I mean, diversity. All those things are things that you bring to the show, and then we can teach and choreograph rhythm around.
Yeah. And everyone creates their own solo moments, so there's lots of space. Little spaces in the show for people to be really individual and really creative.
They do look like they enjoy themselves, definitely.
Oh, yeah. Really and it should really look like it's their show.
Right.
It shouldn't look like they're doing someone else's show.
Yeah, it's their version. It's their version of the show. And it's a very different version to the show that I performed in. Yeah.
Right.
You know, it might be the same choreography, but it's totally different.
Yeah. Different.
And as an example, we've never had a costume design.
Right, they can choose their own.
Everybody creates their own costume. You know, we'll have kind of guidelines.
No sequins.
Sure.
Yeah. And we'll, you know, if someone goes over the guidelines, we'll say something. But generally speaking, you know, it would be interesting to look at photographs of performers over 30 years and see the style of the show change. But it changes imperceptibly. It changes...
Shirts tucked in, shorts shorter. I mean, literally.
It's about time I went again.
T-shirts do this, do this, do this over the years as it becomes retro or becomes fashionable. But that keeps it
contemporary.
I mean, it's never just means that it, and it's very important that it has that flavour
right.
and a cultural flavour. Like I say, it's they're very were very, you know, from a show that started with eight, you know, British people, it's very quickly become a show that is very few British people.
Right. Talking about how it started, look what we managed to find. So we've got one of the old Punter magazines, pictures of
Stomp. That's just a plug for the Punter. There's nothing to do with
it. No, the Punter doesn't exist anymore. Yeah. Who is that?
Oh, Punter again.
I know you said you didn't like to look back and you like looking at the future, but I think that's worth looking
at. That's the Hove Lagoon show.
You've always enjoyed doing sort of grand scale events. I mean, you had at some stage you arranged for a whole kind of orchestra to float.
I think again, rhythm can be very solo, can be very small, but also it's fantastic when there's lots of people.
Large
so like
scale.
You know, 200 drummers is a wonderful thing. In the same way that you know 100,000 people in a football stadium clapping is a very powerful thing.
Yeah.
And so you
want to
experiment with that. Yeah. But then it's also you know a solo flamenco dancer performing you know is the most sexiest and the most wonderful thing
right.
as well.
Right.
So
yeah.
it can change in many forms, I think.
And you two. Let's talk a little bit about you. I mean, you've been working together now for over 30 years. Looking at photos of you, it looks like you really enjoy each other's company.
It's just a fake.
But is that just fake? Go on, tell me the gossip.
It's all for the camera.
I mean, you know, it's got to be a little bit like a marriage, no?
Yeah.
Yes, and we have lots of children.
Right?
All over the world.
Very nice.
Yeah, we're very lucky. We complement each other in different ways, and we're in, to a certain extent we're opposites, and in other sense we're very, very the same. So, and I think you need that for things to work. So.
Okay, and you've developed.
We have very similar tastes, but very different approaches.
Yeah. Right, kind of, which is perfect, isn't it? That makes a real good.
He's nice, and I shout.
Yeah, I've heard that already. But you've developed kind of together. Passion for other things, cinema, the IMAX, for example. Tell me a little bit about that. I know you've always been really passionate about cinema. Still,
Yeah. Well, I mean, I first saw an IMAX movie in Bradford, in Yorkshire, and I was blown away by it. I loved the format. And in the back of my mind, I always wanted to do something in IMAX. And then it's when we just first opened in New York. It, by coincidence, one of the producers of the show in New York had just made an IMAX movie about Michael Jordan. And he basically came up with the idea of saying, why don't you guys make an IMAX? He said, have you ever thought of making an IMAX movie?
Right.
And funnily enough, we kind of both said, yeah, we have thought about it.
It was the best gig ever. They basically, you know, gave us fantastic 65mm cameras and we went around the world shooting all the things that had influenced Stomp.
Right.
So it was a film about the Kodo drummers and about, you know, just literally going to different countries where rhythms and cultures and filming those things, and Stomp was like the MC.
And moving away from Stomp, you did the film about the sardine migration.
We did three underwater sort of conservation type films.
And both of you went underwater, right?
Yeah, well, it's diving's his passion. I did learn to dive as
it
well.
It was
not as much as him.
I think it was after we did Pulse, and then that artistically did very well, and so we then got offered the opportunity to make another film, and we wanted to step away from always being about you know rhythm or music or that, but then also wanted to stay within sort of choreography and underwater is phenomenal. You know, when you see shoals of fish moving and the music you can write for that.
Yeah.
So it was something that we both thought would be great. But we weren't accomplished, conservation filmmakers. So we picked a topic which I'd always wanted to go and do and dive, and then just said we'll do it without any qualification to go and do that.
It was
turned out to be quite a hard gig.
It was crazy. It was really,
fantastic.
There were very high seas and very difficult conditions.
Looked very impressive. Oh. But apart from being impressive, and I guess I can kind of relate it to Stomp as well. Stomp is obviously about entertainment. That film is about something you were passionate about. But there is the element of kind of making the world a better place without trying to sound too grand, I suppose. Because in this film, you have the element of you know, real concern for the environment. Stomp as well, you're aware that you want to reach cultures, you want to put people together, you want to cross the barrier of language.
I think it's about looking at things in a certain way and not always accepting maybe what you're told necessarily. You know, you can make music in many ways, not just the way you're told in a school or by Top of the Pops when I was growing up. Or, you know, you don't have to have a record contract. You know, those things have changed now, but you don't. You can do so many different ways. And I think the same when it comes to conservation. There's all different ways to look at things and, you know, have a look at it and tell that story. And we just like to work. I think rhythm is very important when you edit something, when you write the music to something. I mean, they're all rhythmical stories. Mm. Our conversation has a pace to it about rhythm. You know?
Okay.
So I think it's all there.
We saw particularly the Sardine Run as having a kind of like a symphonic aspect to it. So we wanted to create a kind of ocean symphony.
Right.
But in the process of making it, and I don't think anyone who goes out to work in with wildlife and make nature films, you become an environmentalist by default,
because it's something that happens.
Yeah, because
you're seeing the trauma.
You see what happens, and you see the decline. I mean, even in the 3 years, because we made that movie over three seasons, right. Three sardine seasons. To see the decline just in those 3 years. When we started to, we made a film about coral reefs as well, and I remember we sitting in a bar in Palau in the South Pacific.
As you do.
Yeah, as you do. And the old boys sitting in the corner, old fishermen looking at us, shaking their heads, said, you should have been here 20 years ago.
Right. That's a common theme, you should have been here 20 years ago. I think that's the sad. And now I'm saying it now to my daughter. I just went with her back to Palau and said, you should have been here 20 years ago.
Right.
That's pretty...
Steve and Luke, I wish we could have much more time to talk about these topics, but we have to wrap up. Thank you so much for coming to the studio.
Thank you. Thank you.
Extraordinary people. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions, creating a better space for extraordinary living.